Welcome back dear students and friends. We were discussing this chapter number 5, Morphology of Flowering Plants. In this chapter till there, we have discussed regarding the different organs of a flowering plants like root, stem, leaf and flower. Now today we have to learn regarding the fruit and the seed. So we will discuss today in this session regarding the fruit and the seed. So let us first start with the first one. It's called as a fruit. Okay, so in the flowering plant, the fruit is the result of a fertilization. Which part gets fertilized? It is the ovary gets fertilized and that results into a fruit. So what is a fruit? It is fertilized and ripened ovary. Okay, clear? It is a fertilized and the ripened ovary. Means the ovary, which is a part of a carpel or a pistil, when it gets fertilized, this ovary converts into a fruit. So this is called as a fruit. Fruit is a fertilized and the ripened ovary. That means a fruit is a result of a fertilization. But there are some exceptional fruits. There are some exceptional fruits which are developed without fertilization. Okay, and they are called as parthenocarpic fruit. So what is called as a parthenocarpic fruit? Parthenocarpic fruit means the fruits which are produced without fertilization. They are the fruits which are produced without fertilization. They are called as parthenocarpic fruit. Okay, clear students? So what is a fruit? Fruit usually a result of a fertilization of ovary. But there are few fruits which are developed without fertilization. Such kind of a fruits are called as parthenocarpic fruit. And the example of this parthenocarpic fruit is the banana. Banana that is going to be produced without a fertilization. So that's why we are calling it as parthenocarpic fruit. Okay? Now you know that. Now it is clear to everyone that the fruit that is produced by the ovary, by the fertilization of an ovary, okay? So the based on from which part the fruit is going to be arise, the fruit can be of two types. How many types of a fruit? Two types of a fruits are there. Based on the portion from which they arise, which are the two types? First is called as true fruit. The second one is called as false fruit. Clear? There are two types of a fruit, true fruit and the false fruit. True fruit, that means these are the fruit that arise by a fertilization of ovary, means it arises from the ovary. But the false fruit, they are not arises from the ovary, but they arises from any other part of a flower other than ovary. Remember, if the fruit that is arise from the ovary, then we are calling it as true fruit. But if the fruit that arises from any other part of the flower except the ovary, then it is called as a false fruit. The example of a false fruit, most of the fruit are the true fruit. So I am not giving the example of a true fruit. But you have to remember the example of a false fruit. Because here the example of a false fruit is the apple. Okay? So the apple is a fruit that is not developed from an ovary. But it is developed from a thalamus. It develops from which part? A thalamus. You know that what is a thalamus? Thalamus is the lower part of a flower which is slightly swollen or expanded base. This is called as a thalamus. So the apple develops from a thalamus, not from an ovary. That's why we are calling it as a false fruit. Even the another example, you can say that cashew nut. Cashew nut is a fruit that is developed from the peduncle. Peduncle means a stalk-like portion of a flower from which this cashew nut develops. So it is also not developed from ovary. That's why we are calling it as false fruit. So these are the two types of the fruit. True fruit and the second one is called as false fruit. True fruit that develops from ovary. The false fruit that develops from other than ovary. And the apple and the cashew nut, they are the examples of a false fruit. Now when you see the composition of the fruit, The fruit consists of two parts. Remember, what are the parts of a fruit? The fruit is made up of two parts. Okay? The first part, that is the outer covering of this fruit, we are calling it as a pericarp. What we are calling it as? Pericarp. And inside there, there is a presence of a seed. So if you see the fruit, usually the seed, they are enclosed by some layers. In the fruit, the seeds are present and that seeds are covered or enclosed by some layers. The layers by which they are enclosed, this is called as a pericarp. And inside this pericarp, there is a presence of a seed. We will discuss this seed separately. Okay, clear? Today, later on, we are going to discuss this seed. But what is a pericarp? Pericarp is the covering. This pericarp again can be divided into three parts. Pericarp can be divided into three parts. The first one is called as epicarp, the outermost layer. The second layer of this pericarp is mesocarp. And the third and the innermost layer, it's called as endocarp. So how many layers of pericarp are there? There are three layers of a pericarp are there. Epicarp, mesocarp, endocarp. Epicarp is the outermost, mesocarp is the middle one, and the endocarp is the innermost one. Okay? Like I will explain you with an example of a mango fruit. Clear? So in the mango fruit, what is present? There is a seed which is enclosed by the layers, what we call it as this epicarp. Now the epicarp of, pericarp, the covering of that seed is called as pericarp. The pericarp of a mango, it's divided into three layers. The first outermost is called as epicarp. In case of a mango, the outermost layer, that epicarp, okay, that is skinny, which we have removed from the chart. Okay, that is skinny in nature. The middle layer, which is called as a mesocarp. In case of a mango, the mesocarp is succulent and juicy. Barabar, that is what is the pulp of it. And the endocarp that is present, that is a hard and stony. Barabar, je gutlo je barno che, that is a hard and stony. And inside this endocarp, there is the presence of a seed. Okay, so these are the three layers, epicarp, mesocarp and the endocarp. In case of a mango, the epicarp is skinny, the mesocarp is succulent and juicy, and the endocarp is hard and stony, and inside that there is a presence of a seed. So this is a characteristic of a mango. So the mango, such kind of a characteristic can be found into a kind of a fruit. This kind of a fruit we are calling it as drupe fruit. What we are calling it as? Drupe fruit. Even the coconut is also an example of a drupe fruit. But here the endocarp is not hard and stony. Okay, here the mesocarp is a fibrous in nature. It is not succulent and juicy, but it is a fibrous in nature. Okay, so this is the somewhat different characteristic you can find in a different kind of a fruit. Or even if you consider the tomato and the orange, in the tomato and the orange, the inner part is not even a hard. That means endocarp is not a hard. Okay, so such kind of a different kind of a fruits are present. But as of now, you just have to remember that the mango and the coconut, they are the examples of a drupe fruit. Okay, so this is a somewhat information regarding the fruit. So in short, what is a fruit? The fruit is the fertilized and ripened ovary. If the fruit is developed without fertilization, then we are calling this fruit as a parthenocarpic fruit. The fruit can be two type, true fruit, false fruit. True fruit develops from ovary. Most of the fruits are developed from ovary. That means they are true fruit. But there are few fruits which do not develop from ovary, which are called as false fruit, like apple and the cashew nut. The fruit consists of two parts, pericarp and the seed. Seed is covered by the layers, what we call it as pericarp. The pericarp is further divided into three layers. Outermost epicarp, middle one is mesocarp, innermost is endocarp. So these are the characteristic of a fruit. Okay, so that's all about a fruit. Now we have to learn regarding the seed. Okay, clear? So now we are going to start with a seed. Usually the seeds, they are present inside a fruit. So let us see what are the components of a seed and what are the structures and the types of the seeds are there. So let us start first with a seed. So what is a seed? You know that fruit is a result of fertilized ovary. And you already know that within that ovary, what is present? Ovule. Ovules are present in the ovary. And the arrangement of ovule within an ovary, we are calling it as placentation. That we have already discussed in the previous session. So when ovary gets fertilized, it converts into a fruit. Similarly, when ovule gets fertilized, it converts into a seed. So you can say that, what is a seed? It is fertilized ovule. The fertilization of an ovule that results into a seed, that results into the formation of a seed. So this is a fertilized ovule, it's called as a seed. Okay? Now, this seed, what it composed of? When you see the structure of a seed, the seed usually consists of two parts. What are the two components of a seed? First, covering of a seed. The covering of a seed, we are calling it as seed coat. And the second one part, it's called as embryo. Clear? There are two parts of a seed. Seed coat means covering, and the second part, it's called as an embryo. Okay? Clear? Now, we will discuss each part. But this embryo can be further composed of what it consists of. The embryo consists of embryonic axis. Clear? What it consists of? Embryonic axis. The second thing, what it consists of? It consists of cotyledon. And even it also consists of endosperm. Clear? What it consists of? Endosperm. So you can say that this, or you can say not endosperm is a part of an embryo, that we will discuss separately. Barabar chit, clear? But as of now, just remember that the embryo that consists of an embryonic axis and the cotyledon. Clear? I again repeat, what's a seed? Seed is a fertilized ovule. It consists of two parts. The covering is called as seed coat, and the second one is called as embryo. The embryo consists of embryonic axis, and the second one is called as cotyledon. Now, based on number of cotyledon, the seed can be classified into two types. Okay, so the seed can be classified into two types based on the number of cotyledon. The first type of a seed is called as monocotyledonous. First one is called as monocotyledonous seed. Clear? The second type of a seed is called as dicotyledonous seed. How many types of seeds are there? There are two types of a seed based on the number of cotyledon. Monocotyledonous seed, dicotyledonous seed. Monocotyledonous seed means, mono means a one. They have just a single cotyledon. And the dicotyledonous seed means they have a two cotyledon. So that's why we are calling it as dicotyledonous seed. So based on presence of cotyledon, there are the two types of a seeds are present. The examples of a monocotyledonous seed, like for an example, it is the maize, or you can say a castor. Okay, these are the examples of a monocotyledonous seed. And the examples of dicotyledonous seed are pea, bean. These are the examples of a dicotyledonous seed. These seeds have a two cotyledon. These seeds, maize and the castor, they have a one cotyledon. So this is called as monocotyledonous and dicotyledonous seed. Okay? So we will discuss the characteristic of both kind of a seed. Dicotyledonous seed as well as a monocotyledonous seed. First of all, we are going to start with a characteristic of dicotyledonous seed. So let's first start with a dicotyledonous seed. So let's discuss the structure of dicotyledonous seed. What is a dicotyledonous seed? In the dicotyledonous seed, it consists of two cotyledon. here. That's why we are calling it as dicotyledonous seed. But we will discuss the each part. Like the other seeds, it is a seed. So obviously it consists of two parts. It is a seed, so consists of two parts. The first one, it's called as seed core. And the second one, it's called as embryo. Clear? Now we will first discuss regarding this seed core. You know that what is a seed core? Seed core, it is the covering of a seed. What is a seed core? It is covering of a seed. Clear? It covers the seed. That's why we are calling it as seed coat. Okay? In the dicotyledonous seed, this seed coat, it consists of two covering. How many covering? Two covering are present. The first one, the outer one, it's called as testa. And the inner one is called as tegmen. How many seed coat are present in the dicotyledonous seed? There are two seed coat is present. One is called as a testa and the second one is called as tegmen. From this testa and the testa is comparatively harder in nature, which protect the seed against some adverse conditions or some environmental condition. It protect the seeds. Okay? So in the dicotyledonous seed, the seed coat consists of two layers. Outer one is called as testa and the inner one is called as a tegmen. Okay? So this is the two layers you can find as a seed coat in a dicotyledonous seed. Now apart from this seed coat, what you can find or what you can see in the dicotyledonous seed? You can find or you can observe the hilum. Okay? So what is a hilum? Hilum is the region, it is the region present on a seed, by which it attaches to fruit. So what is a hilum? On the dicotyledonous seed, you can find the presence of a hilum. Hilum is a region, or you can say it's a kind of a scale. It is a kind of a scar. That region or the scar that is present on the seed by which the seeds are attached to a fruit. So this is called as hilum. Now above the hilum, there is a small pore is present and we are calling it as micropyle. So what is a micropyle? The micropyle is a small pore. It is a small pore present above the hilum. It is a small pore, a small opening which is present above the hilum. Through this pore, the water enters, even the air will enter, and this water and the air, they are responsible for a growth of a seed, and thus the seed will develop into a big plant. Okay, so the seed will germinate and it will lead to a generation of a new plant. So this is a small pore. Okay, clear, through which the water enters, and this is known as micropyle that is present above the hilum. So these are the two regions you can find, hilum and the micropyle. Hilum is a scar by which the seed is attached to a fruit, and the micropyle that is present above the hilum, it is a small opening which allows the water to enter, and hence the seed will germinate. Okay, so these are the two regions, specific region you can find in the dicotyledonous seed. So this is all about the first part of a seed, what we are calling it as seed coat. Now we are discussing the second part, what we are calling it as embryo. You know that, as we have discussed previously, that what embryo consists of? So the embryo consists of two parts. Embryo consists of two parts. The first one is called as embryonic axis. And the second one, you can say that it is cotyledon. Clear? Embryonic axis and the second one is called as cotyledon. Now, first of all, we will discuss regarding this cotyledon. It's very easy. You know that we are discussing this dicotyledonous seed. Means it indicates that how many cotyledons are present in it? There are two cotyledons. How many cotyledons are present on the dicotyledonous seed? Two cotyledons are present. How many cotyledons are present? 2 cotyledons are present. Like I will show you over here. Suppose, see the example. Okay, clear? So here, how many cotyledons are present? Here you can see that. There are 2 cotyledons are present. 1 and the 2. Okay, clear? If you open this seed, like the bean seed. Okay, this is an example of a bean seed. Barabar chai, clear? So if you see the example of a bee, and you open, because it's very easy to observe and eat the bee, so that's why I have shown this example. Okay, clear? So if you open this, you can find the 2 different cotyledons. So here, there are 2 cotyledons are present, and that's why we are calling it as dicotyledonous seed. Okay, so this is about the cotyledon. Okay, next, regarding the embryonic axis. Now, in this embryonic axis has a 2 parts. One part is called as plumule, and the second part is called as radical. The axis, embryonic axis, like this, this embryonic axis, okay, it has 2 parts, like see, 1 and the 2. One is plumule, the another one is radical. So the plumule, it develops into a, you already know it, the plumule, it develops into a shoot system. And when this seed will germinate, the radical, it develops into a root system. So these are the 2 parts, plumule and the radical. They are the parts of embryonic axis. On one end of embryonic axis, there is a presence of plumule. And on the another end of this embryonic axis, there is a presence of radical. Plumule, it develops into a shoot system. The radical, it develops into a root system. Okay, so this is the characteristic you can find in it. Okay, so there are 2 cotyledons and embryonic axis are present. Now, the another important characteristic you can find into this dicotyledonous seed, that is, endosperm is not present, or the endosperm that is going to be consumed by the developing seeds, the endosperm which is present, that is going to be consumed by the developing seed. So that's why this dicotyledonous seed, in other term, you can also call it as non-endospermic seed. You have to remember this. The dicotyledonous seed is called as non-endospermic seed. Okay, clear? The examples of this dicotyledonous seed, you already know it. It is a pea and the bean. They are the examples of a dicotyledonous seed. Okay, so that's all about the characteristic of this dicotyledonous seed. Now, we have also have to discuss regarding the components of a monocotyledonous seed, but that we will discuss in the next session. Till then, students, keep ready these 2, fruit and the components of a dicotyledonous seed. Okay, so students, keep learning, keep watching, like and subscribe this channel. Thank you for watching.